Okay. I'm going to ask the members of the panel to introduce themselves.
Hi, I'm Jody Gray. I work for CAL FIRE, Riverside County Fire. I'm a battalion chief, and we respond into the area. We have an emergency. Thank you.
Good evening, everybody. I'm Jerry Hagan. I'm the Emergency Services Coordinator for the county's Emergency Management Department assigned to District 3, which encompasses Idyllwild.
Françoise Frigola, Board Member of MDP and Director of Idyllwild Emergency.
I'm Chad Bianco. I'm a Lieutenant with the Riverside County Sheriff's Department out of the Hema Station, and I'm responsible for patrol investigations and volunteers from Sheriff's Hema Station that will be responding up here.
My name is Mark Lamont. I'm with the Idyllwild Fire Protection District. I'm a battalion chief here locally in Idyllwild, and I'm also on a U.S. Forest Service Fire Management Team, Southern California Team 1.
Adam Rodriguez, Captain with Idyllwild Fire Protection District. Also with the station captain in charge of the district if we had something in town.
Good afternoon, I'm Ernie Calderon. I'm the ZEST Program Manager for the American Red Cross for Riverside County. And Idyllwild is one of my areas that I cover.
Well, thank you all for coming. The community really appreciates having such expertise.
Good evening, I'm Bill Tell. I'm president of Mile High Radio Club. We also have the responsibility for WNKI through the direction of IFPD.
Bill's a little shy of me, so. Okay. I want to mention that there's a lot of material that has been prepared to give you this evening, and we have an hour and a half to do all of this. So, panelists, and for everyone else to know, we're going to try and limit each of the topics, of which there are nine, to 10 minutes each, and not beyond that. Okay? So, the first topic is the general topic of fire science. And Mark, Jerry, anyone else who would like to jump in? Under the topic of fire science, there's some issues that should be addressed in terms of general information for all of us, including how fires are assessed in terms of their potential, their rate of spread, their direction, threat to us, and the need to evacuate. Anyone want to lead off with that?
I will take it.
Sure.
I'm not sure if you want me to use that or.
Yes.
Will I be loud enough?
Yeah.
Use the mic?
Yeah, use the mic.
Okay.
I'll step off here to the side just a little bit so I can see the screen as well. Fire potential on the hill. How many of you were here during the 2013 mountain fire?
That's everybody.
Fantastic. So if you want to see fire potential, you need look no further than that. Our hill, with the grasses that are growing out there right now this year, is set up in a line again for great fire potential. Now, it's been said that rookies and idiots predict fire season, so I'll try to stay out of those categories. But I will tell you that you are in an ever state, an always state of great fire potential living here in the mountain communities, okay? You live in the midst of the wilderness, basically, and the potential is great. You've decided to build your homes and to live out in a very rural area, and there are several reasons for you to make sure that you keep your property defendable. What we're looking for, we just started our LE 100 program. We just talked about that at our board meeting today, we're at about 68%. Our inspections will be complete by May 1st, and I can think of no better way for you to help all of the agencies that are going to be involved in an incident that evolves around fire than to help us by keeping your property defendable. Okay? How do we do that? We limit and eliminate fuels. All right? Fire's potential is only as great as the fuels that will carry it. So we're greatly concerned this year with the light, flashy grass fuels that are growing out there. We were ever grateful and blessed to have the rains that we had and to have some of the recoveries that we had, but that is going to create a greater fire potential for this year. So the number one way that you can help us be prepared for that is to make sure that you follow all of the instructions found in your LE 100 letter that you will receive this year if you failed your fire inspection. Okay, we are only sending out letters if you fail. So if your neighbor gets one and you did not, congratulations. You have passed this year's fire inspection. In the past, we sent one to every one of the property owners. That's just about 4,000 mailers. And so in an effort to keep that cost down, right now we're at about 26% fail rate, with 68% of the inspections completed. That is actually very good, so I commend you. In looking back in years past, we've had fail rates up to about 40%. So to be down in the mid-20s is fantastic. We'd like to see it at zero. And again, we would ask for your help in getting there. Am I to take questions?
There's going to be a question and answer period afterwards.
But I wanted to ask him, how come Pine Cove doesn't have it?
I suppose I don't understand what you mean.
They don't have a letter.
So I don't know. I'll let Jody speak to that.
I didn't hear the question.
Sherry,
Pine Cove doesn't
Sherry,
have what?
They have letters if you fail, believe me.
Oh, yeah, we do it all in the entire county.
In the interest of time, we need to hold the questions until the end. We have some time reserved until the end, but otherwise we're not going to get through the evening in terms of the agenda.
Okay, so I'll run through this fairly quickly. Rate of spread, living on the hillside, anytime that you live uphill from fire's potential, the rate of spread is going to be fast, all right? Let me just say this to simplify it. You cannot outrun it. It can't be done, okay? Direction. Fire tends to take the path of least resistance. It wants to consume as much fuel as possible. And so drainages, right, hillsides, those are the places. Anytime you see, if you live at the end of a drainage, or what we call a box canyon or a chimney, those areas are in high fire potential for high fire activity. It is very difficult to defend in those locations. But again, fire is gonna take the path of least resistance and a path that has fuels. So if the fuels have been mitigated, then fire is not going to carry up through those areas. Threat to the hill, again, I'm gonna refer back just to keep this simple to the 2013 event. How many of you guys did evacuate during the mountain fire? Most of you. Great. Thank you for that. So those evacuation orders, and I'm sure we're going to get into that here in a minute, those evacuation orders do not come without great concern for your well-being. Okay? Being on a management team, I have sat through many of hours while that gets contemplated, whether or not we are going to pull the pin on evacuation. So that is not something that people just show up one night and say, you know what, I think we ought to evacuate. There are complexity analyses that take place to decide whether or not we're going to bring a team in to manage that fire. And along with that, it pours several hours with the experts and the professionals to decide whether or not we're going to go ahead and pull the pin on evacuation. But the threat to the hill is great. Need to evacuate. All I can say is if you get an evacuation order, it's not because we don't want you to evacuate. Okay? And that seems to be, I've had a lot of people, well, you know, that's just a suggestion. When you get to the point where you get asked to evacuate, it is no longer a suggestion. Several hours have been poured into that decision, and believe me, it is not taken lightly. We know that it's an inconvenience, but we're going to put your life well ahead of that inconvenience and ask for you to evacuate when the time comes.
Thank you, Chief. The next topic is obviously important for all of us if we're considering evacuation. How do we get the information? And we have a number of resources available to us on the Hill, from reverse 911 to the Winky system, idlewildemergency.com, and also Francois has a caveat about trusting social media in terms of sources of information. Jerry, you want to start?
Well, again, my name is Jerry. I'm with the County Emergency Management Department. And the first thing I want to talk about is the what everybody terms the reverse 911 system. Reverse 911 is actually a brand name like Xerox and Kleenex. So every tissue you ever pick up is a Kleenex. We use the system in Riverside County known as the Early Warning Notification System. The name isn't all that important. It's what you think it is. It's a way for us to contact you through your telephone lines and through cell phones to give you information on how to evacuate. I will say that everybody who here still has a landline telephone hardwired to their house, okay? You're already in the system. When we purchased the system and put it online, we got that database. It comes with it. So who here has only a cell phone? A lot of folks are going to strictly cellular phones, okay? You have to register your phone into the system, and I encourage you to do that. Up here tonight, and I brought a bunch of them, is a simple set of instructions on how to register your cell phone. Okay. As with the decision to evacuate you, which as the chief said, is never taken lightly, we will not use the EWNS system to tell you that there's going to be a meeting. We don't use the system to deluge you with the local news. If we're calling you, it's very important. And again, that decision has not been made lightly. The people that are entrusted to make that decision are schooled in what the trigger points are to make that decision. So I can't stress enough, and I'm just going to piggyback on what the chief said. No professional is going to ask you to leave your home without a lot of consideration. It's a dire emergency. Just can't say enough about that. WNKI, in the event that there is an evacuation that is ordered on the Hill, or if there is a voluntary evacuation in effect prior to a mandatory, we'll be reaching out to Idlewild Fire to go through WNKI and start a, and I'm told, correct me if I'm wrong, Bill, basically start an announcement on a loop.
That is correct.
Okay. What's the range of WNKI?
Not that great at the moment. Primarily Marion Ridge to the north and to Mountain Center to the south.
And what frequency do they broadcast on?
1610 kilohertz on your AM radio dial.
Okay, sound like a radio announcer. So when we do notifications like this, professional agencies take what we call a shotgun approach to this. We're going to employ, my agency is going to employ their PIO. County Fire, Idlewild Fire, their PIOs are going to be sending out information. The Sheriff's Department, anybody with an official voice is going to start sending out information. You're going to get information via, if you're on Twitter and you follow EMD, we're going to put it out on Twitter. We're going to contact Francois. We're going to have it out on Facebook. We're going to have it over the radio. And if it comes down to it, we're going to have it on loudspeakers with cars. Most likely sheriff, driving up and down streets using the public address system, telling people to evacuate. You, unless you live under a rock, you're gonna know it. You're just gonna know. We are not going to let that go unnoticed. So, okay, I'm gonna let Francois talk about Idlewild Emergency.
Yes, Idlewild Emergency is going to send you a lot of information. They have always been verified. So I'm going to ask you, if needed, plug your brain in, and please do not share forward just about everything. During the mountain fire, I spent a lot of my time saying, no, 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 please stop, stop, stop. Okay? I know people are scared, and that's another reason to rely on good information. You'll be less scared if you know what is really going on. Okay? I don't want to go just say we'll send you information via email, text to your cell phone, Twitter, Facebook, and on the website. Furthermore, as soon as he can, Bill will send us an email with whatever is going on Winky, so that people that are not in town will know. We will again send that on email and put it on the websites. So stick to what is real and try not to be scared. Keep your feet on the ground. Verify the information only.
Okay, just to be clear, Idlewild Emergency is idlewildemergency.com, and it is the brainchild. I'm getting signals that it's the brainchild of Francoise, and she put it into effect shortly before the mountain fire, and as a result of her efforts, Francoise, how many hits were there? How many employees were there to Idlewild Emergency?
Still not working.
Yeah. It's going on and off.
Okay, the question is to show you what a resource it quickly became during the mountain fire. Tell us how many resources,
We had about 1,800 people following us, and we have more now.
Yeah. So, and how do people register for idlewildemergency.com?
You go to idlewildemergency.com and you can subscribe to alerts, your cell phone, and please, if it's your cell phone, put a cell phone number, not an email address, because that's a lot of work for me. And you can also put your email. We are on Twitter and Facebook also.
So, we in Mount Disaster Preparedness are very grateful to Francoise for the infrastructure that she has helped to establish. Bill, do you have anything to add about Winky?
I could talk about it for quite a while, but
you got 3 minutes.
I don't know if this is.
Actually, I'd like to ask the audience, how many know of WNKI? There's quite a few of us that know about it. Of those that know about it, how many can actually receive it at their home? So about the same amount, or close to. We're working on expanding its performance capabilities on this mountain. WNKI was the brainchild of George Covington nearly 30 years ago, and he worked with many of the folks at the fire department and such to create that system. It gets out the notification to the community when your cell phones aren't working, when power's out, because the fire station does have backup power. So when everything's getting taxed and you're not getting through or getting those transmissions on your cell phones, you can still get WNKI 1610 AM to get those notifications. The notifications do come from IFPD or the PIO that would be assigned to the incident. It's through our agreement that we have with IFPD that has formulated that. So I would imagine that we would have unified command, and if there was one voice from command, and hey, we got to get that message out, that's going to come to WNKI. We want to put it out in a short message so that it's concise. As people are driving through the community, no more than 1 or 2 minutes. We did get some practice, obviously, with the system back during the mountain fire and the silver fire. That was prior to the radio club's agreement with IFPD. But we learned lessons from it, and we're taking those forward. We hope to get a new system up on the air here rather quickly. It'll be much more modernized, and it may even enable the PIOs to directly put the message on there, as opposed to asking a volunteer to do that, or us being in the way if they need to get it done quickly. So, yes. Public information officer, yes.
Bill, you gave the AM frequency, there's an FM frequency also?
No FM frequency at all. It's strictly AM. Now, the new system, with the technology that we're bringing on board, has the capability of live streaming. We have not done that yet, but live streaming would enable it to go over the internet, potentially. So we can look into that as well. And then so those remote areas that may not hear the radio signal could possibly log in and get it on the internet. So those are some technologies that we're looking at with the new system. And again, look in the Grier, we'll get some articles out. We need to do a little more PR for the station and such. And anyway, that's really all I've got.
Okay, I ask people not to ask questions, but one of our VIPs for general information, where is the Winky station located?
The Winky station is located at IFPD. So the antenna is in the valley here, and that's why it's not able to get out beyond the ridges, for example. And we do have a strategic plan that we've created nearly 2 years ago, but that plan to roll it out requires funding, and we're looking at placing linked sites that would simulcast all along the corridor 243 and 74. So we have an ambitious strategic plan in place that we want to push out on and get those outlying areas hearing the communications. Quite often, I remember Peter Lent years ago telling us that cell phones and the towers, cell phones are oversold, much like your seats on the airplane.
Right.
So when you go and everybody jumps on their cell phone, the towers come down or they go offline, and then it takes several hours possibly to get reconnected or reestablish their service. So again, with our AM broadcast, it operates on emergency power, and it has no impediments in that sense.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
The next issue is how to leave. Obvious for many people, but not for everyone. Jerry, can you talk a little bit about transportation issues?
Certainly. Okay, so transportation. How many people have a way off the hill? How many of you have a plan? sort of. Get in the car, point it that direction. Well, we're going to take care of direction for you. When somebody pulls the trigger and we get that evacuation order, one of the things that we've already planned out is what your evacuation routes are. We'll tell you where to go. If we don't tell you to go there, don't go there. Okay? There's a reason for that. The response agencies are going to be moving resources and apparatus up and down all these roads. So we're going to be involving law enforcement, Sheriff's Department, Highway Patrol, and Caltrans to cordon these roads off so that we're getting you out of the way. So just go, if we tell you, go down to Banning, but you want to tell me that your grandchildren live in Hemet? Go around. Okay. So just go. So we'll take care of the evacuation route for you. We'll tell you where it is. I'm going to address. Anybody here an off-roader? Hey, no driving down B Canyon. Okay. Stay off the dirt roads with your four-wheel drive vehicle. You're driving in unburned fuel. Not a good idea. Okay. I'm with the Hemet Jeep Club. I know people who will actually do that. So now on a very more serious note, is there anybody here that knows somebody who may have an access or functional need or some sort of a disability and not have transportation off the hill? Okay, a family member?
No, it's a lady in the neighborhood who is blind and doesn't have a car anymore.
Okay, I apologize for having my back to you.
That's
you snuck up on me.
So for those who may have an access or functional need or not have transportation, your first line of defense is you. Okay, you have to be responsible for yourself. I urge you to get a plan. Learn who your neighbors are. And my suggestion is have somebody that is willing to help you evacuate, get off the mountain if need be, and have that be three deep. Have three people. Okay? Make sure they live on the hill. Okay? If you're calling your kids or grandkids in Temecula, they're not going to be able to get to you. It's going to have to be people on the hill who are willing to load you in their vehicle and evacuate with you. Okay. Now, for those who may have access or functional needs or possibly be bedridden or homebound, your last line of defense on this is if you absolutely have to, call 911. Okay. Every effort will be made to get to you. But we don't want to make that our first line of defense. We don't want to make that our go-to, because in the event that something has gone wrong to the point where we feel we need to evacuate this entire hilltop, we're busy. Fire agencies are busy, law is busy, EMS is busy, emergency management, we're probably setting up shelters, working with the Red Cross. Okay. Somebody will eventually come to get you, but it could be a little bit. So make us your last line of defense. Okay. Have a plan, and again, 3D. Okay.
Thank you. Anybody else on the panel?
As for the condition of leaving your home, I'm going to leave that to my fire brothers and sisters and how they want your house.
I'd just like to add a couple things. We're talking about evacuations, and one thing that you might be asked to do is shelter in place. If the fire is too fast, it's coming and blocking roads, you may be asked what they call shelter in place. Stay in your home, shut the doors, don't block them, turn the lights on so we know you're there. Take away all of the flammable curtains, because you know what happens when heat goes through glass. If you have like wood shutters, you would want to shut them. Turn off your air conditioning so you don't suck in smoke and all that kind of stuff, and we'll come get you afterwards. One of the reasons why I keep saying we're busy, if you decide to stay when we ask you to leave, we're probably going to have to divert resources to rescue you. And that puts our life at danger because you chose not to listen. And it's very true and it's very real and it happens a lot. We'll have to take air resources away from fighting the fire to maybe drop on your home or drop a path so we can get to you. So you guys know how serious it is. You live through it, you know, and you fear it every day. So one of the things I wanted to add to what we do when we come up here, every day we get weather reports. We have experts, not 50-50 guys on the news going, well, you might, you know, have this weather, you might have this. We have scientists and we have what we call FBAMs that get dispatched to these fires. They're working before the fires happen. They know the potential. When it's set up here, the scientific, we have all of these formulas that they do. They know what the pretty much, you know, the wind direction, what the wind's blowing at 20 feet, what the wind's blowing at 50 feet, what's moving in. So, like you said, you can't predict fire, but you can come real close. You know, but the wind can change on a dime. You might say, you know, I'm not going to evacuate. The wind's on that hill blowing that way. Well, guess what? Maybe you don't know that we've got a change coming, and it's going to turn 50 degrees. On our website, Riverside County Fire, we have all of the information tips for evacuating, for doing your defensible space to prepare your home. There's quite a few things. Like you said, we do inspections, but most of the time, the truth is we don't have enough staff to go door to door to tell you, hey, your grass needs to be this high, you need the leaves off of your house, and those kind of things. So it's almost on you to educate yourself. And I know a lot of it you probably know. You've lived here for years. It's common sense. But some of it you might not realize. Wood piles around your home, cutting the grass around propane tanks. But all of that information's on there. What to grab before you evacuate. Things you might not think about. Medication, family photos, things that might make you turn around. Your dog's medication. Your dog's, you know, that kind of thing. So there are many checklists and stuff that you can do. One of the other things wanted to let you know is our priorities are life, your life, like you said, evacuations first. You guys are what's most important. Get off the hill so we can do our work, so we don't have to worry about you. We will worry about you. Then your property, then the infrastructure, so like power lines and water sources and those kind of things, and then the environment. So you guys are our number one priority. I think you mentioned Unified Command. That's one of the first things we're thinking when we come up here is these guys are the experts. They live up here. They go on the calls every day. They know the terrain. We're going to come up. We have resources that the Hill doesn't have, aircraft, dozers, crews, more personnel, F-bands, the weather people. But we don't have the expertise. We don't have the knowledge base that you on the Hill, your everyday fire department has. So we're going to work together hand in hand, and we're gonna make it work. So that's all I have right now.
Thank you. For general information, who among you has handouts that people should be aware of? Jerry? Anybody else?
Mark? Yes, we have them over here, and I think we have some more coming because there's more folks. I think we had 50 of them, but we have some more coming. So I see some of them out there, and much like Jody was just touching on, that's an evacuation safety and preparedness checklist that the Ottawa Fire Department also has on their website for you to go through. And of course, if you have any further questions, we would always ask you to call us or visit our website at ottawafire.com, and you can pick up most of that information there. Touching on something that Jerry said, I'll be real quick. We also keep a binder of those people. Now, if you have the ability to get off the Hill, we want you to utilize that. But if you do not, if you are incapable of getting yourself moved in an evacuation situation, we want to know about that now. We want to know about that today. So come by and visit the fire department. If you don't know where it is, it's over on Maranatha. Come by and visit, because we do actually keep a binder. We will be able to better assist should you need that assistance if we know about it well in advance, rather than finding out about it after the event takes place.
Thank you, Chief.
Yes.
Next topic, very important in terms of preparedness, is the go bag, so-called. And Jerry, are you going to talk about the go bag?
I guess I'm up again.
Exercise.
Okay, I've got a pile of flyers up here. So, does everybody here have an emergency kit or a go bag in their vehicle? Okay, got some work to do. Does everybody have a home emergency supply kit in case you have to shelter in place?
Yeah.
You're in your home for 3 or 4 or 5 days and you may not be able to get to the store. Okay, this is really my wheelhouse. This is what I talk about a lot. I preach this day in and day out. You've got to have a kit. You've got to be ready. Because in emergency management, we live by the creed that the first 72 is on you. No matter the disaster. It doesn't matter what the disaster is. People have got to be able to... how many people do we have here in the audience today?
18.
Okay. 28. Bunch. How many response professionals do we have up here?
Fewer.
We're outnumbered. We're absolutely outnumbered. We cannot get to everybody. You have to take care of yourselves. I'm not going to harp on it too much more, but this small packet I brought has got an excellent example of what we call the trash can kit. It'll show you how to build a home survival kit and store it inside a standard size trash can. Okay. Great. Put the lid on, forget about it. Okay. We also have some lists of things you can put in your car as a go bag. You know, what if the evacuation occurs and you're not on the Hill? You've got your kit in your car. Okay. So you've got enough stuff to where if you have to go locate yourself at one of our shelters, that you have the things you need to get through this incident. Okay. some other things. We all have important documents, right? Who here is a believer in being paperless and putting everything on a hard drive? Okay. Everybody else just loves the feel of paper, right? Okay. I urge you to begin to love the feel of a fireproof safe. Okay? So that if you can't get to your documents, they're safe. Or, if you have a small portable container that is, again, fireproof, when you get set to leave your house, grab it, take it with you, you've got all your important documents with you. Okay. Let's see. Okay. I know that there's going to be a really small number, but how many people might be on, say, a long-term medication? So, you need to have medication, and you need to take it with you. Now, this is a little difficult because of the way the insurance companies work nowadays, okay, is having that extra supply, maybe a 10-day supply of whatever you need. My suggestion is talk to your physician. Many times they get samples from pharmaceutical reps that you can store for emergencies. And tell them that's what it's for. Or ask your doctor if he would be willing to put an extra prescription through to the insurance company just for a 10-day supply of important medications. Ask your doctor for a copy of your prescriptions. Put it in your fireproof box. That way when you leave, you have a copy of your prescription with you if you need to stop at the Rite Aid or the Save-On down the hill. Okay? Pharmacies are mailing a lot of stuff now, or I'm sure there are pharmacies here on the hill, correct? You won't be able to get to them. No. So if you need those medicines, there's your avenue. There's one avenue for actually having them with you. Okay. Photographs? No. Definitely grab your photo albums. You know, keep them where you can get to them. Having them scattered all over the house, not such a good idea. You know, if it's something that's that important to you. The half tank rule. Okay, half tank of gas is out of gas. Okay. I'm going to relate a quick story. I was talking with one of the response team members who went on the incident management team to the Oroville disaster, where they evacuated the entire town of Oroville, when they evacuated the whole town. Guess who left too? The gas station attendants. They closed the doors, they locked the pumps, and they had people waiting. It ran out of gas in town. They couldn't evacuate. They had to bring back school buses in order to get the people out of the area. Because, well, you know, the people who were running the gas stations didn't want to drown any more than the people who were trying to evacuate. So, again, half a tank is empty.
Move on to routes out of town. Not sure. I think Jerry has something to say about that.
I don't show it, but let's leave that there.
Yeah.
This kind of started a little bit. Jerry made a comment about us directing you out of town. You want him to go the other way. Trust me, we know which way you should go, and we know the best way to go. And you have to listen to us. We aren't just showing up here and flipping a coin and deciding what street we want to route you all out of. It's well planned in advance. We have the personnel to do it between fire and between law enforcement. The good thing about, if you want a good thing about an emergency, regular law enforcement, we may all the time say that we're understaffed and everything else, but in the event of an emergency, we will have plenty of personnel up here for law enforcement purposes, which includes getting people out of town. If a street is barricaded, or if we have a cop car with lights on, or a fire engine with lights on blocking a street, that isn't meant for everybody else. It's meant for you. Do not go down that street. We don't care if you forgot something. We don't care if you just had that one more thing, or that you don't like going that particular road, or you can't drive east between the hours or whatever. We don't really care. You'd be amazed at the excuses we get of why people have to go a certain direction. We will direct you out of town. The routes will be very clearly marked with plenty of fire trucks and police cars. Please, please, please do what you're told. Really, that's all I can say. We put a lot of effort into making sure that everybody up here lives through a disaster, lives through a fire. And part of that has to be, and it's been mentioned several times, you got to take care of yourself first. And taking care of yourself means listening to us, because the last thing we want is any of you injured, because now we have more personnel that we have to take away from the things we want to do the things that now we haven't planned on, because you decided to take it about your on yourself to do it your own way. So please, please, please follow the routes out of town. They will be clearly marked. We'll have policemen, sheriff, plenty of cars, plenty of fire trucks directing you. I know I've repeated myself. Trust me, somebody's going to not know that I repeated myself. Is that clear? Please, please, please just follow directions. Follow directions.
Does that... I guess that's clear.
It's not, trust me.
One of the subtopics that Mike put on the slide was alternate routes. We're not supposed to, if I understand you, use dirt roads or...
That's
roads.
Correct. Absolutely do not use a dirt road. The routes out are the main thoroughfares that we can control. And if for whatever reason the fire changes direction and takes out a road, we will direct you around in a different way, but we have to be able to manage that. We can't monitor every road in town. We have to monitor the main thoroughfares, where everyone is directed to and where everyone is going out, whether it be either direction. But absolutely do not use a dirt road, because we can't take care of you on a dirt road, and somebody already said it, that you're just driving in through fuel. So absolutely no dirt roads. There may be a dirt road that you have to cross to get over to back in the direction that you have to go to the main thoroughfare, but B Canyon is off limits. And any other route that you think you used last summer and it seemed fine, all of those are off limits.
Just one thing I'd like to add to that is that one of the things that's a major part of our egress is our ingress. We're trying to get fire equipment up. Big pieces, dozer transports and crew buses, and you know, I've been a lot of fires where we've had to pull over and start fighting fire, you know, right there and stop something, maybe a spot fire or something which blocks the road. So even if you talk to your neighbor and go, oh no, that road's clear, because they don't see anybody, no, we're coming up. So they plan egress and, you know, and like he said, if something goes wrong, alternate routes and that stuff. It's all planned out. They're all thinking ahead and that thing. But just keep that in mind. We got a lot of equipment that you might not see moving into the area. One other thing that popped in my head, too, we're talking about media and stuff. We do have Facebook, Riverside County Fire. They try to notify people. Keep that updated as they go. We have a lot of PIO crews that will come up and work with PIOs that are here. And do you work with our PIO with the radio station?
We need to get more versed with who your PIOs are.
So absolutely. We
can
have full-time.
Maintain proper
connection. Yeah, we can get together after.
Yeah.
I can use some contact information, definitely. This sounds like a great program.
Yeah, generally with Winky, by the time you're going to pull an evacuation, this won't happen every single time, but a management team is generally going to be here. It wouldn't happen in every occasion, but the state and the U.S. Forest Service have management teams, incident management teams, and that PIO is going to give direction so that we're funneling it through one location so that that message that gets out remains the same.
You're addressing fire emergencies. What happens if a catastrophic earthquake and we can't get out?
Shelter place.
So let me just briefly answer that, and I won't veer off too far. Incident management teams are in-depthly prepared for the team that went up and handled Orville would be considered a fire management team. And that wasn't a fire. And so those incident management teams are prepared for those situations to deal with those, as, and they would be for an earthquake as well.
Mark, could you mention the DASs, the disaster aid stations?
So I think probably you guys would be, we have disaster aid stations through MDP that are all situated throughout the hill that will be opened in the event of an emergency where you were sheltered in place. So we don't want you congregating at the DASH units. If you are asked to evacuate, please do not go to a DASH unit. That doesn't mean evacuate yourself to a DASH unit. All right, those places are not made for that. They will have limited supplies, medical supplies, food, water, and things of that. Okay, fix it. Back it up. So they will have minimal supplies to get you through a shelter in place. But that is all. So if you're asked to evacuate, which is why we're here tonight, you need to evacuate. In the instance of a shelter in place, you'll be directed.
And the location of the DAS in front of the post office is a big red glass screen with all the information there. And they are on the NDP website also.
Not to get off point too much, but it's very important that everyone realize that there is no way in which we are adequately prepared for a disaster of sufficient magnitude that all of us would be trapped up here. We are doing our best in non-disaster preparedness of the organization, other non-professional groups working with the professional groups. But the key is your own preparation, because there just aren't sufficient resources otherwise to take care of everyone should something that catastrophic occur. What's next? Shelters. Okay. I want to take this opportunity to, first of all, introduce Pat Schnetzer, who's a member of our core medical group and mountain disaster preparedness, who has been our Red Cross liaison for a number of years, and through her efforts, we have how many people registered with the Red Cross up here?
We probably have really 20 active members now.
And the Red Cross, by the way, has been very good to Idlewild in terms of sharing resources, coming up here and giving us training, giving us lectures. So, Jerry, I think you have something to talk about as far as shelters.
And let's let American Red Cross
talk about
Ernie, shelter.
Ernie Calderon is the district manager for Riverside Chapter.
Well, thank you for allowing us to be part of this panel. Thank you very much. shelters. We're talking about fire, and we're talking about natural disasters also. The Red Cross will be there. The Red Cross is a humanitarian organization. That's what we do. We do it nationwide. We do it international. Should there be a fire up here, we're going to depend on EMD. We're going to get our directions from EMD as to what we need to do, where that shelter is going to be. And when law enforcement says the shelter is going to be in Hemet, don't listen to anybody else. Use that route and get down to Hemet. We will take care of you. Bring your go bag with you. We have a tremendous amount of resources available to you. I was at a Glendale FEMA class on logistics about a month ago, and we had four people from Red Cross. There must have been about 250 people there throughout all of California bordering states. They kept referring back to Red Cross. Red Cross will be there. Red Cross will help you. And we will. We will. That's why, that's what we do. Nationwide, international. In your go bag, if you forget your go bag, I want to touch on what Jerry said about medications. We have a tremendous casework department. We have people locally in Riverside County. If you forget your medications or eyeglasses, we'll get them for you. We have those partners that get them for you within a couple of hours. And people don't realize that. That's what the Red Cross does. If we do open up a shelter on either side of the mountain, whether it's Beaumont, Banning, or whether it's San Jacinto, Hemet, possibly Temecula, if you're in that shelter, we'll provide everything for you. We'll also provide with our partners for you. Can't bring your animals in the shelter unless it's a service dog or a comfort dog. But if you have an animal with you that is part of your family, we have seen it in the past where our partners come in and set something up, usually within walking distance of the shelter. So your animals you can be with during the day, but at night they're taken care of. So you'll get 3 hot meals. You'll get breakfast, lunch, and dinner. And whatever else you need, blankets, cots, that's what we do. That's what the Red Cross does. Yesterday, the Red Cross Riverside chapter celebrated 100 years of its charter here in Riverside. We provide a number of services, blood services. Tracy and Pat here have been very instrumental, as well as Dr. Goldberg. And I just lost your name.
Jeffrey.
That's right. You have great representation up here. They don't only stay up here, they go down below. They go to Temecula, they go to Menifee, they go to Beaumont, Banning. If somebody loses their house to a fire, the Red Cross is there. Red Cross is there to give you money to make sure that you're taken care of until the insurance company comes through. So we're there for you. We're always trying to recruit new volunteers for this. Our door is always open, and I'll leave the questions for afterwards, but if you have any questions, I'll be here, as well as some local Red Cross members here. We're very close with fire, and EMD. Jerry would be our contact up here at the main, and that's where the communications comes in. The Red Cross does fire, follow, and has adapted the incident command system that fire follows. We do follow that. We're not first responders. I was a responder, first responder for almost 40 years with the department up here. Retired as a fire chief, and so we work very close. We have a lot of that from Orange County in the Riverside area, where we have retired fire captains from LA County, Orange County, Los Angeles City. So we're well represented in what we do. We do it good. So if you have any questions, I'd be here to help you, but we do.
Is Safe and Well activated in case of a major fire, or is it just other disasters?
I didn't hear all that.
Safe and Well?
Safe and Well is activated when the shelter is in place.
Sure. Okay. You want to explain Safe and Well?
Safe and Well is, it's on the net. It's a list of every shelter that's activated during a certain disaster. You can go on Red Cross under Safe and Well and register. If you have a family member you're looking for, you can put your name on it, and Red Cross will help you find your family member.
And Ottawa Emergency will also help you.
If you get power knocked out up here because of a snow, blizzard, or something, we'll come up here and open up a shelter and take care of you. If you don't have generators, we'll make sure Ottawa is taken care of. No advance, but spots. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for coming up. I want to introduce Tracy Felipe in the back. He's also a member of the Corps Medical Group and Mountain Disaster Preparedness. And he has become, by default, I guess, the go-to person when there is a DAT, a disaster aid team call, usually from a fire in which people have been displaced from their home. And I've had the experience a couple of times of going down to Hemet with Tracy on a call. And to give you an idea of the resources the Red Cross provide, was one family of four who lost their home, and Tracy went down, and very, very quickly, I would say within 30 minutes, they were taken care of. They were given a credit card loaded with over $1,000 in funding for them to use. They're that fast and that resourceful, and Tracy kind of leads the pack up here in terms of responding. Okay, how do we return? How do we know when to return and by what route? And how do we get past the sentries who might be posted and try and return? Who wants to handle that?
I'll start.
Sure. Okay.
I'll be with the first bullet point.
How will you know? It's very simple. We're going to notify you that you can come back to your home the exact same way we told you to leave. Okay. If you're in a shelter, that notice will be posted in the shelter.
we will be broadcasting it on local radio. KFROG 95.1 is part of the emergency alert system. They're registered with FEMA. We will be putting out notices on KFROG. We'll be putting it out over the local radio stations. It will be on the official Twitter, Facebook, and social media pages of every official agency that's responding to this incident or that is responsible for the Idle Wild area. And I'm going to double up on what Francois said. Just because you saw it on Billy Bob's Facebook page that the mountain is open, check out the official source. Because we don't want you to pack up all your gear and think you're heading home and get to a checkpoint and have a deputy or a highway patrol officer tell you that's as far as you're going. Okay? That leads to frustration. That leads to people becoming impatient, and it just doesn't go a good direction. So official notification only. Okay? Our goal is to get you back to your homes as soon as possible. Okay? As far as with the checkpoints and ID, I'm going to leave that to Lieutenant Bianco.
There could be times, or there may be times, or there will be times that we could just all clear and everything's safe and we'll all leave and everybody can come back. There may be times where we have the roads still closed and only residents can come back. In that case, if there is a checkpoint and there is a roadblock, you obviously can't come back unless the official notification sites have told you that residents are allowed back in. You will have to have with you your ID and proof of residency. This may shock some people in here, but criminals lie to us. And they tell us they live here when they really don't. So if we're only letting residents back in, you have to have something that proves to us that you live here. Whether it's your driver's license with your address on it, if you have multiple homes and it doesn't say that, you need a utility bill that you took with you when you left, or your vehicle registration that shows this address. You have to have something with your name and address that shows that you belong here, or we're not going to let you in.
You need a street address. The P.O. box,
PO box
does
doesn't
work.
Go. It has to show that your name on your ID matches an address. It could be your electric bill, any utility bill, a registration bill. But please, 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 especially if you're in this room, don't be mad when we turn you away when you didn't listen to me and take those things. Because we do know that people will come back in, they'll say they have to get in, that they live here, and really they know that the community is empty and thieves take advantage of disasters. And we're here to make sure that doesn't happen. But again, you have to help yourself.
Please wait until you are being told to come out. Do not try to come early, you complicate things. I beg you, don't try. You wait. You have been gone for 2, 3, 7 days. Half an hour is not going to make a difference. So be patient. Okay? Thank you.
Any other questions? Any other comments for the panel? If not, we'll move on to our last topic, which is evacuation mandatory. The sheriff is
the chief has told me that he's going to make sure everybody leaves. Okay. For semantics, legally, we cannot make you leave your house. Now, if your stuff, if your couch and your pictures are more important than your flesh and your life, then you really have your priorities a little bit mixed up. I'm sure your friends, your family, and your kids would rather talk to you than look at old pictures. I own a home in another state in a mountain community. Let it burn. I don't care. I'm not going to, sorry kids, Dad had to go see if he could close down the roof so we didn't lose the house. Please, please, please. It was talked already. We didn't just come up and say, you know what, let's kick everybody out. Let's make sure they all leave. Let's tell everybody they have to evacuate. We're doing it for a reason. Sometimes we care more about your lives than you do. You're not thinking straight. You're thinking irrationally because of the mementos in your home and the memories and everything else. but we are actually thinking more of your life than you are. And sometimes our life, because we have, if we have to go in and get you when you weren't supposed to be there in the first place, then you're putting a fire crew and law enforcement in jeopardy, their families and themselves, because you were selfish about your own property. Please, it's not that important. We cannot make you leave, but when we tell you that it's time to evacuate, it's for a good reason, and just plan on it. It's a beautiful place to live up here, but when you came up here or when you got here, you had to realize that there were dangers. Please heed the dangers, and if you're asked to leave, please leave. We know that there are going to be people that don't. We hope that it's maybe one, and then we can only worry about one, but we're begging all of you, care about yourselves, care about your families, care about your kids and your relatives somewhere else, and go away until it's safe, and then come back.
Thank you. Anyone else?
I'll just add one thing. And that gentleman really wants to ask a question, so we'll get him first. There are a couple of exceptions. You can, as the lieutenant said, you can opt to make the decision yourself. There are some people you cannot make that decision for. Okay. Minor children. You will not be allowed to make the decision to keep your children. If you're going to stay, we will not allow you to endanger them. We will literally take custody of your children and take them to an appropriate shelter. If you have a person with access and functional needs, possibly somebody who's homebound or bedridden in your home, you don't get to make the decision for them. We're going to come get them if we know about them. Okay? So remember, you're making that decision for yourself. We're not going to let you make that decision for somebody else.
Okay. Questions and answers for other patients.
I just like to add, Mark came up with a little bit about how to take care of fire abatement. Our charter, the Fire Safe Council, that's what we do up here, okay? And absolutely, we have two people there that will come out and show you what has to be cleared out. It's no cost, all right? If it's a big job, we have grants, 65, 35, 40, and if you're really, really hurting for money, there are other possibilities, but you have to discuss that with the police. But we're that's why we're there, is to teach you how to clear your property.
Susan?
What do you do about absentee neighbors who won't clear doors?
That question's gone on for 15 years. I can't answer it.
I have absentee neighbors on both sides of me.
Question, what about absentee neighbors
who don't clear their
property? That's the LE-100 program. That's what we do. That's why we go out. That's why the fire department goes out and they give a notice. But it's also a long process. They have 30 days to correct it. And then we go out and give a second notice. And then they have 30 days to correct it. And then it would start into the then go to the prevention, and then it has to go through the court system, and then what eventually happens is they'll go out and clean it for them and put a lien against their property. But that's the court system, which is so backed up. We just hope that they take the notice and do what they're supposed to do. One of the things I'd like to add, since we're talking about clearing property, and just if you're deciding to clear your property, the grass is changing color rapidly, do it in the early morning hours. Do it with a water source available and a shovel, fire extinguisher or hose, something, because if it sparks, you hit a rock or something, that causes more fires than you can imagine. And a lot of people, even with the water source, it gets away from them because it's such flashy fuels. So just make sure you're prepared. One of the things you can do, and you can talk to him about it, is do the perimeter first. So if it does catch on fire, you've already built your square, so if it catches on fire, it's not going to go anywhere. So think about that, little things, and I'm sure the Fire Safe Council can give you more tips on. But think early morning, not 2 in the afternoon.
We recently had a large snowstorm. Everybody knows about that one. But our neighbors had electrical line that was touching a tree because of the snow, and it caught fire. SCE came, we had about seven to win at the fire department. If you notice, anybody neighbor that has that kind of a problem now, because we also had the neighbor next door has one of their lines is touching several trees. SCE has the right to come in and take care of that on their own without your permission.
We turn off our propane tanks before we leave, or does it make any difference?
When we evacuate.
When we evacuate.
So yes, we would encourage you to turn your propane tanks off. If you have trouble or don't know how to do that properly, we would encourage you to call your propane provider.
And well, they'll teach us too how to
correct.
Do it.
Correct, instruction on that. Yeah. The answer is yes, we would prefer that you turn that off. If you have waited and the evacuation is imminent, if it's up against that, then we don't want you to do that. We just want you to leave. But if you are leaving at the appropriate time under the evacuation order, we want you to close all the windows in your home. We want you to turn off your air conditioner. We'd like for you to leave a porch light on, okay, or a light on in the interior of the house. It will help us in seeing what's out there, but we would like for you to turn off.
Did you say you wanted us to turn off our electricity?
No.
Okay.
Your propane.
Okay. Just
your electricity is not flammable.
Okay, but if a wire goes down or something, wouldn't that?
So
whatever.
The
don't turn that off. All right. We used to have a little slip that once we evacuated, we would put it on our front door, say everything's out, no animals, no sick people, we're gone. Do we still do that?
We do not do that currently.
Because of burglaries? Or
There are several reasons why we had discouraged that originally. Yes, and that's one of them.
But yeah. Plus we have, when we evacuate, because we have a fire family, we usually go before it's really called.
Great.
Wouldn't that be a suggestion for somebody who has family down below?
We would absolutely never discourage you packing your things and leaving early. There is no law out there that I know of that requires you to stay until you're told to evacuate.
Yeah,
and so
there's no traffic either.
Correct. And you will get out ahead of that rush.
Yeah, right.
So yeah, that's a very good point. Leave as early as you possibly can.
Now, since we love firemen, ours and you, is there any way to get to the media and not make heroes out of these people that stay and put our fire people in danger?
So, like we're saying right now, the heroes that stay behind generally don't live here. They're coming up from other locations to help mitigate the threat, to mitigate the fire, right? People who are staying after they've been told to evacuate aren't helping at all.
Well, I know that, but the media shows them that night saying, oh, these people stayed and saved their house with their fire hose.
I don't know if you've seen the type of suppression equipment that we have, but our hoses are bigger than yours. And I would venture to say, I would venture to say that you'd be hard pressed to find a fire personnel that would tell you that someone, you've all seen that on the news, someone standing on a roof with a 5/8-inch garden hose. If they saved their home with that garden hose, it wasn't in a threat position in the first place.
Right.
Okay. So I don't want to talk badly about those people because they've made a decision to stay on their private property, right?
I'm talking about the media people.
So our PIOs do the best job that they can to get the information out, and I will tell you that all of them will tell you to evacuate as soon as possible when ordered.
Okay.
Period. That's everybody. That's not, hey, a couple of you guys stay and try to defend your homes. Evacuation is evacuation. Everyone needs to leave.
Thank you. I'm finished.
Phil?
You've given us a lot of great information, but the majority of the people who live out here are not here.
So it might be a good idea to contact Jack and Becky Clark and have them have a series of articles in the paper, not only giving out the information you've given us here tonight, but what to do in case of a major earthquake, what to do in case of a major ice storm, a snowstorm, and also maybe what to do as far as packing up a bag for your car or your house for emergencies. It could be a whole series of articles that spread a lot of great information.
Sure, and they do have representation here tonight, so I'll make sure to talk with them.
Thanks, Mark.
You're welcome, Mark. We do have some of these handouts up here. We have an evacuation checklist. It is also available on our website. Please tell your neighbors about it, idlewildfire.com. There are several other Ready, Set, Go. You can go on all the different websites and take a look. We tried to keep this simple because I found that if you write 5 or 6 pages, by the time somebody gets to the second page, they're falling asleep. So we've put all the major, these are the minimum things, right? This isn't to limit you from what you should put in your go bag necessarily, but these are the things that should be in there. And so if you get an opportunity, pick one of these up tonight, take one for a friend, drop by the fire station, we'll print you a few copies for your neighbors, and or go on our website and just simply scroll down through there, take a look at the information page, and this is in there. Okay.
Can I take a moment to introduce our leader, Mike Fader, who put this evening together?
He says no.
So, when you talked about leaving the hill, are there any restrictions to what kind of vehicle you can take? Big motorhome, travel trailer, or?
No. Just as long as you're leaving, we're happy.
Yes.
During the mountain fire, I had both my phone numbers registered with reverse 911. Everybody else was getting calls. I never got one. And I was a little frustrated with that, and I even tried to contact somebody. Nobody got back to me. I was informed, because I'm a pet sitter, and I was keeping informed of everything, but I'm just curious why I never got a call. Did not everybody get calls, or what? I mean, I don't know what else to do.
You were registered on the county system. Mm-hmm. You should have gotten that call. So.
Jerry, depends on the area, too.
Yeah, it's gonna. You may have just accidentally been outside of the.
I even went back in and re-registered.
I can't explain what type of catalyst. I wish I could. All I can say is, right? Yes. We have contracted with a new company, so going in and registering again might be the trick for you.
Okay. All right. Thanks.
So,
yes.
Something about the 911. Of the reverse 911, they do geographical area. So if they did a block and they said, okay, we're gonna evacuate, I'm sure the mountain fire was everybody, but they can do just certain areas. If there's a gas leak and they want to evacuate 2 blocks, you might be on one side of the street and they stop at this side of the street. So just be aware of that too. They can set up by street, by geographical area.
One thing though, if your neighbor got a reverse 911 call and said to evacuate, you should have too. If you didn't, don't stay home because you didn't get one.
So I was everywhere and I knew everything that was going on. Okay. But I was just concerned that everybody else was getting 911 calls and I didn't get one, so I was trying to figure out why.
It's definitely odd because it is computer generated and it goes from a database that's in the computer. So it definitely is odd.
Yeah, well, hopefully it's
the guy with the Kansas City hat's got to ask his question.
I've been looking for weed eaters for fire abatement around the house. And I was wondering, especially the fire officials, is gas or electric better?
That's my question, too.
Because I know gas sometimes sparks.
For fire? No, I don't think there's any difference.
No.
Yeah, there's spark arresters for like motorcycles and those kind of things.
Right.
But I think with weed eaters, no. I prefer gas because they're stronger. And
yeah, me too.
Who likes cords?
But I have 150 feet of electrical cord too, so.
Yeah, I don't believe so. I don't believe there's any difference.
Okay, great.
Fire.
That's all I
want
to know.
If you have a friend with a sheep or a goat.
Yeah.
We'd
love to have a goat. We'd love to have a goat.
Yes.
You said that possibly streets would be blocked and they would direct us out of town. Is that since the mountain fire? Because there, I didn't see any blockages at all in any of the streets as I left town.
It's possible that they may not be blocked. It's possible that we could leave them open, but direction of travel will be controlled. And if, I can't tell you what it's going to be because until we know what the fire is and what the fire is doing, we don't know.
But is this since the mountain fire then?
No, it should have been before.
Really?
You know, we learn something. Every time something happens, you learn from it. But I can't speak for that, but I don't know.
If some roads were blocked, for example, the road to Humber Park was blocked. To give you one example.
Susan?
What do you do to protect our homes from vandalism while we're away?
Like I said, the question was, what do we do to protect your home from vandalism? It is nice if everybody leaves. I don't know if I said that yet. If we can get everybody to leave. Also, what I mentioned before is in a disaster, we no longer have personnel problems. We have plenty of people up here. And we also know that criminals take advantage of disasters. So we take a very active, proactive role in making sure that your property is safe. We are appreciating you leaving, so we're going to do our absolute best to make sure that when you get back, your stuff is still here, that your house didn't get burglarized and everything else. Which kind of goes to, if you don't have the ID to get back in, we're probably not going to let you, and you're going to get in an argument with a deputy because, or a highway patrolman, because they know that crooks are trying to come in here, and they will try and come in the back ways too, and that's what we're doing, is trying to prevent that. So I can promise you, we go overboard in bringing the personnel in here to make sure that your houses are safe.
During the mountain fire, there were enforcement officers from Los Angeles, from just about everywhere. They were covering the hill. They didn't know how to read map for us, but that's
any other questions?
I just have one more thing to say. If you're interested in any of the services that the Red Cross provides, or you want to volunteer, I suggest you go online at redcross.org. It'll tell you everything about our shelters, everything that the Red Cross does. So I encourage you to do that. It'll talk about our shelters also.
Yeah, I can only add Red Cross is such a critical resource. We have some very committed members of the Red Cross that Pat, Tracy, have helped to bring into the fold. Yes, Pat?
We can use more volunteers for Idlewild. For instance, we're talking about fire, but if there's an earthquake up here, say it's during the Jazz Fest, people can't get off the hill, we're going to be opening up a shelter up here, and we need people to man it. A few years ago, there was only two volunteers who could have opened a shelter, and you need at least six. So now we have enough, but we're all getting older, and some people drop out for various reasons or move, so we always need new volunteers. So if you're interested, go on redcross.org. I think it's /Riverside if you want to get right into our...
To wrap up, we started the evening with three objectives. First of all, we wanted to provide information on what you needed to know on the information. So we have introduced you to the professional resources up here. as well as a little bit about fire science and judging things like direction and how you might expect a fire to behave depending on the terrain that's involved. We try to emphasize avenues of communication, of which there are multiple, that you would be able to take advantage of. Another objective was what could you expect in terms of efforts to protect you, guidance in terms of leaving the hill, and resources and facilities for both you and your pets should you have to leave the hill and not have any other resource available in terms of where to stay. Finally, in terms of what to do, emphasis, of course, is on preparation of your home site as well as a go bag and your medications. And finally, being prepared to follow instructions as far as how to leave, what routes to take as directed. So those were objectives. We hope we came close. And thank you all very much.
Thank you.